climbing school wasn't exactly a boot camp either.
Improvisation, I would say, and perhaps informality. Dougal tended to employ people that he knew and who had climbed with and that he was friendly with. Dougal liked the clients who were good climbers. I mean, he was friendly to everyone, but he found the basic instruction a bit boring, I would have to say, and he liked working with the high flying students more than ourselves, perhaps. So, I think the slogan at the school in those days was "Come and dangle with Dougal," but very often they found themselves prattling around with Paul in the lower Alps, perhaps.
Stretching advanced students on the planning and calculations involved in tackling the more serious routes was one thing for Haston. Stretching himself on the day-to-day running of the school was quite another.
He wasn't an administrator. Running the climbing school was not his idea of fun. I mean, he would do the minimum to get advertising sorted out and keep the administration going, but it certainly isn't something he would have gone into.
But of course, it was also a very nice place to be socially. It was, after all, the 60s. It was the time of sex, drugs, rock and roll, and I suppose Lazan was having a party the same as everyone else.
The Vagabond was the heart and soul of the climbing school to a great extent. It was run by a great guy called Alan Rankin. He's a Canadian who settled in Lazan. And it was a bar for travellers, basically. And the travellers were mainly English-speaking. It was the scene of some quite memorable evenings, none of which I can remember.
Beth Parry and I, who both trained together at Guy's, for various reasons, decided to spend one single summer working as vag hags in the Club Vagabond. There we were, two nicely brought-up young ladies, found ourselves in this incredible place where we'd never heard such language, such four-letter words in our lives. And then we met a new breed of people called climbers, who we'd never met before.
Haston was still recovering from the frostbite sustained on his Eiger epic when he met the woman he would marry 2 years later.
It was in the kitchen of the Vagabond. I even can remember what he was wearing, black jeans and a black polo neck sweater. His nails were so soft and he had just had to harden up before he could, climb anything. And we used to go on these amazing walks and Dougal would suddenly disappear up a rock. Ah bon, d'accord, I'll pick some flowers and just sort of...
The bar was really a private club, which means, you could not only play around, you had to follow some rules, and some rules were also broken. But we had a lot of fun, really a lot of fun. There was no really closing time, if you see what I mean. So often we would look at the sunrise and the sunset, of course, before going climbing.
Dougal socialised with the best of us, and more so in many cases. I mean, I had to go to work. I was teaching every day, and we had an early start, and I would have to get up some mornings. Well, every morning I'd be up at 7 to go down to the American school and start teaching at 8. And very often I'd be briskly walking down, and there would be Dougal returning from the Vagabond Club, not staggering, but, shall I say, weaving his way home after a sociable night in the Vagabond.
The old urge to excess was still alive in Haston and regularly let out for exercise in Lesan. But with an expedition or big climb in prospect, his preparation was totally committed.
He would have phases of doing quite a lot of partying, and then he would stop and just not go near it for several months, and he'd go training and get fit. And he managed to keep a balance on the two lifestyles.
Dougal was extremely athletic. And also he had this power of concentration, which is essential to go climbing. If you're not well in your head, you better stay home. So that he was always able to wind himself up in such a matter that he was really reaching high levels.
On the very corner, right at the top of the picture in the center, is Dougal Haston. You may remember that he was the man who put up that tremendous direct route on the north face of the Eiger, which took them a month
Part of the celebrity mountaineer phenomenon of the late 60s was the televised climb. Watching a few ant-like figures making almost imperceptible progress up a cliff might seem to challenge audience attention span, but these live broadcasts proved highly popular, and none more so than BBC's 1966 assault on the Orkney sea stack, the Old Man of Hoy.
On the bottom right of picture, you can see Chris Bonington.
I've got to climb right up into this chimney, which looks pretty hard as well.
The Old Man of Hoy outdoor broadcast was probably the best they ever made. And the route that Dougal and Pete did was highly technical. There's a bit of aid climbing in it as well, and it was very spectacular. But the whole thing, it was great fun.
Hello, Chris.
Hello, Dougal. You've had some pretty wicked bivouacs. How does this compare?
I feel much better than I did on my last bivouac in the Eiger, which was a step cut out of the ice, and I was sitting in slings then.
What sort of temperatures?
Oh, the average temperature was minus 40 centigrade, and the wind was around about 100 miles per hour.
Not exactly melting in the light of celebrity, Haston nevertheless opened up with presenter Chris Brasher to a degree he rarely did in more conventional interview circumstances.
Dougal, what drives you to attempt these sort of routes that are really going to take everything out of you?
I just like finding out what makes myself tick. And this is a good way of doing it. When you drive yourself to the limit like this, you really get to know something about yourself. You learn the limits of your physical and mental endurance in really difficult situations.
Haston's quest to explore his limits took him from the Alps to the Andes and from the Dolomites to Yosemite. Then in 1970, Chris Bonington asked him to take on his first Himalayan challenge, the unclimbed south face of Annapurna.
This was the strongest climbing team ever to leave England. Nine Britons and one American, all of them experienced on dangerous mountains throughout the world. None more so than the Scot, Dougal Haston, the first man up the perilous direct route on the Eiger.
Are you professional?
No, amateur.
It was professional, all right. Bonington's Annapurna expedition is still rated as one of the very best organized and executed of any in the Himalayas. Annapurna was Haston's first experience of climbing with oxygen, and his first of working with the phlegmatic English ace, Don Whillans. Each was wary of the other, and each had a lot to give the other.
Partnerships are interesting things, and on the south face of Annapurna, which was the first time, of course, that Dougal had climbed with Don, I think Dougal immediately saw in Don someone whom he could learn an immense amount from, and he naturally went to him.
I do stop now. I admire the views and I relax in the atmosphere and everything else. I appreciate the scenery, but I know that this scenery is very dangerous. And first and foremost, my approach to the mountain is a practical one. Whereas I think to do this a wee bit more romantic, I'd be perhaps taking more fuss about things where he just put the sack on and just waft off and take whatever came, whereas I would More of an engineering type.
It's wrong to say I'm romantic about climbing. That's totally wrong. I mean, I'm analytic about climbing. But I'm not romantic about it. Climbing is a total life form almost. It's not just a trade. It's also there's an intellectual side of climbing. There's a practical side of climbing. It's almost a whole life form.
Later, Haston came up with a one-liner that neatly summed up the difference between himself and Whillans.
Don had a job to do and was doing it. I had a life to live and was living it.
Bonington had put together a team of eight climbers working in pairs and taking it in turns to establish the route and ferry supplies up from base camp. Gradually, the extreme conditions and arduous load carrying at altitude took their toll. Bonington was faced with the ultimate team leader's decision. Who was going to the summit?
I think right from the word go, I perceived both particularly Dougal and perhaps Don as my potential summiters. And so I was quite happy to let that relationship, if you like, that partnership, go on.
For 2 days of unrelenting storms in temperatures of minus 40 and with oxygen supplies exhausted, Willen survived on melted ice and tobacco, Haston on porridge. It seemed the summit was beyond them.
We had the feeling that the weather was really crawling up on us.
Yeah. I mean, Dougal had been in favour of this dash, but I'd not been in favour of it. As a last resort, I was going to do it. But when I got up that morning, I thought, well, this is it. Last resort morning. So we just went for the summit, and I reached the ridge. It was blowing a howling gale. And I just sat there and waited for him to pop over the top and walked onto the summit, which was just only a few yards away, just a high point on a ridge of ice, and he took some film, and then he went on to the top, and I took a bit of film.
Hello, Camp 6, this is Camp 4. How did you get on today? Over.
Well, we had some good news for you, sir. That's
very little elation because we've got to get down, and because of her being beaten back a few days beforehand in really bad weather. I think that was in the back of both of our minds. And I think the first moment of real elation was when we sat back in the tent at Camp 6.
Yeah, he was quite chuffed with himself then.
What did he say then? Or what did he do?
He said, I feel slightly high.
Stop. The summit pair were Don Willens and Dougal Haston. Stop. Roger, so far.
Elation was wiped off the face of the expedition when, during the descent, Ian Clough, who had been with Bonington on the first British ascent of the Eiger, was killed by falling ice. A year after Annapurna, Haston and Willens were invited onto a Himalayan expedition that proposed to showcase the values of international cooperation, with a first ascent of Everest by its southwest face.
Hello, Mary.
Morning, gentlemen. Morgan, bonjour.
The physical challenge was such that for Haston at least, the idealism had to be taken with a quiet pinch of salt.
Dougal wrote me long, long letters, and he said, this is my sort of diary of the expedition. So he'd write down, you know. It was a wonderful one of the, this was just a postcard because they were still on the approach march. And he said, well, we're all great friends at the moment, but we haven't got to the mountain yet. Which showed a lot of prescience in that, because then the various nationalities did. Dougal wasn't a political animal at all. He was there to climb the mountain, you know, and he wasn't about to do the yak route. Is that, that's what the Sherpas call the, you know, the route normale.
Progress was hampered by fiercely hostile weather, teamwork by too many languages and too much sense of national honour. The death of the Indian Army climber Harsh Bahaguna added tragedy to the recriminations. Disillusioned, demoralized, and weakened by illness, half the expedition followed the French delegation and walked away. Well above the acrimony, and after 3 weeks above the oxygen line, Haston and Willens also reached the end.
Did you say climbing finished? Climbing finished. Over.
Positive. Only Dugard and Don, only bodies, no more, yeah. Because it's very tired. So, you know, only they can carry down, no more. So.
Okay, just bring your bodies, and we'll be very, very happy to see them at that. Over.
It suddenly just came into my head, you're not going to do it. You're not going to come to any harm either. Too crafty for that.
Yeah.
You carry on.
Well, okay, like this, then.
Yeah.
The following year, Haston and Whillans were back on Everest's southwest face, but not together. Whillans joined a largely Austrian expedition, while Haston teamed up with Bonington, his old Glencoe friend and mentor Hamish McInnes, and a new kid on the block, Doug Scott. Both these 1972 attempts failed, but in Scott, Haston had found a new climbing partner, whose strengths perfectly complemented his own. Meanwhile, his marriage with Annie was nearing its end, and he had found a new liaison partner, local girl Ariane Giobellina.
I was at VAG with girlfriends, and one of them said, look, this guy, he's a perfect man for you, she says. And I looked at her, I says, you crazy. And I'd never seen him before. Anyway, a bit later in the evening, I sort of went to have a closer look. And I had no idea who he was. And I think that's probably was the very best for both of us. And then I thought, maybe my girlfriend was right.
In 1974, Hollywood came to Haston, hiring him as climbing advisor on the filming of The Eiger Sanction, starring Clint Eastwood. The script called for some scenes actually to be shot on the north wall of the Eiger, and some of the actors, including Eastwood, opted to do their own stunts. Filming was halted when one of Haston's assistants, Scotsman Dave Knowles, was killed in a rockfall, and resumed only after Hamish McInnes was drafted in to add his engineering expertise to the safety team. One of McInnes' first jobs was to stage a stunt that required Eastwood to fall off the Eiger backwards.
This was quite a difficult thing to set up, and I had a good look around, and really the best place to do this was very close to where Dave was killed, you know. And Dougal wasn't very happy about this, but I went up with him and persuaded him, you know, that where we're going to do this, the rock was actually okay. And Clint shouted up, he says, is this safe? I says, yeah, it's probably safe, but we wouldn't do it, you know. Dougal agreed with that, you know. Mm-hmm. And then Clint got his Swiss Army knife out, and he said, well, let's get the darn thing done, you know. Cut the rope like that. It's very cool, you know. So immediately fell out of sight, and fell about, 20 feet, 30 feet or something, and swung under the overhang held by Dougal and on the other rope.
When in 1975 an unexpected opportunity arose for another attempt on Everest's southwest face, Chris Bonington was under no illusions about the expectations of his lead climber.
Dougal assumed that he was going to be the guy who went to the top of the mountain, but he just took it absolutely for granted because he knew he was the best, and he was. And as far as I was concerned, if you like, as a team leader, where he wanted to go was where I also wanted him to go.
He was a steady guy, Dougal, that's for sure. I always thought he was very much like a Sherpa, very self-contained, quite reticent, really, very economical, never wasted a step or a breath. Certainly didn't suffer fools gladly.
Bonington rated Doug Scott's talents as up there with Haston's, with the other team members some way behind. So who else was going to the summit?
I saw them as by far the strongest pair I had. And then I debated quite a bit about whether I kept them together, which would mean that any second summit bid would be that much weaker, whereas if I split them up, it meant that the two bids would be stronger. Dougal was a very, very close friend, and I confided in him a lot and discussed a lot of things with him. And he said, no, I'd like to climb with Doug. And there's no doubt about it, on that ascent that they made together, they built a friendship that I think went much further than convenience.
I don't remember having a cross word with him on any of the trips I was on. He just seemed to keep out of all that and just not provoke it in any way whatsoever. Just quietly confident in his own abilities and just inspired everybody else around him.
Well, you can make the leader very clearly. You can get the occasional flash as well of...
On September 24th, just 4 weeks after the establishment of base camp, Bonington and other members of the team watch for glimpses of Haston and Scott. High up on the mountain, and carrying with them the hopes, dedication, and skill of the entire expedition.
We should have a complete line of fixed rope right the way across the
trail. Hey, look at that hole going down that groove on the left.
Whereabouts?
An avalanche missed them by about 50 meters. The last hurdle of the Hillary Step proved trickier than expected, and it wasn't until 6 in the evening that they reached the summit, just in time for sunset.
Dougal wasn't into photography. He always thought that he didn't want anything to get him in between him and the climbing experience. But he was kind enough to take a photograph of myself. As I did, I said, well, take one if you wouldn't mind, just for his mother, which he agreed to do. Sometimes when I'm driving along, I'll think of old times and the lads and Dougal in particular. Think what might have been and what was, and feel all the elation that we then felt. Just standing there looking at the sunset, which was just amazing as it filtered down through the cloud. 3 or 4 times it would disappear and burst out again. Finally, it went, and then we thought, we better go as well.
As Haston said on Annapurna, you still have to get down the mountain. That means safety first, and nightfall meant a snow hole at a height where you start to die.
Oxygen had run out before we got into the cave, so there wasn't a lot of fuel around in our bodies to create heat. And strange things did happen. Well, Dougal starts to have a very long and involved conversation with Dave Clark, our equipment officer, who of course was down at base camp. The way Dougal was talking, it was as if he was right there in the cave with us. And I actually was beginning to wonder about him. I think perhaps he's getting this cerebral edema, until I realised I was in and out of conversations with my feet. They'd become like 2 separate entities in the cave, besides ourselves. And I was actually addressing the right one, I was saying to the right one, what are we going to do with the left one? And the left one replied and said, well, you never use me.
Next morning, having survived the highest bivouac ever, at temperatures of around minus 50 degrees, Haston and Scott descended to Camp 6 to radio their news down to Bonnington in Camp 2.
Hello, Doug. It's
great to hear you. Did you make it, over? Wonderful, Doug. Congratulations from every single one of us. We're listening out the whole time, so as soon as you've got yourself sorted out, you can come back to us. But meanwhile, congratulations from every single one of us. Well done.
While 2 2-man teams set out for their summit bids, Haston and Scott counted the cost of success on 10 fingers each.
Well, Dougal and I found we hadn't got frostbite. We had a bit of frost nip, a little bit of black on the ends, but it was obvious we managed it unscathed, and so we could relax and just enjoy the aftermath of being so focused. You know, you're so much at peace with yourself, and you feel so clear-headed as your strength starts to return. And our reveries were suddenly shattered, really, by the news that Mick had disappeared, Mick Burke.
After his partner had lost a crampon and been forced to retreat, Mick Burke had gone on for the top solo. He was never seen again. The following year, Haston and Scott were in Alaska to make an alpine-style ascent of North America's highest peak, Mount McKinley, at a latitude that made thin air all the more deadly. What came off the approach plane, personnel and kit, was all there was for a piratical raid that achieved a new route on a mountain regarded as an American climber's preserve. Haston had kept detailed diaries throughout his climbing life, and in 1972 had collected them into an autobiography, In High Places. Back in Lazar from Alaska, he turned his hand to a novel, working at the manuscript in the mornings and taking to the hills with Ariane in the afternoons.
We liked to hike a lot, and at one point Dougal stopped and looked up, and I says, what are you looking at? And he just says, oh, I'm just trying to see the best route to come down this mountain. And then I thought, it's a bit steep for me, and I looked at him sort of joking, and I said, well, you might go up there, but this time I won't come with you. And then we carried on our walk, and of course this was the exact place.
The exact place was the Riondas Mountain where the hero of Haston's novel, Calculated Risk, goes skiing on a bright winter's day and expertly, if narrowly, escapes an avalanche.
His reactions were fast and automatic as the slope to his right began to move. Down and to the left, everything was still stable. Checking in mid-turn, he pointed his skis down and, going very fast, reached the safety of a boulder.
The Riondas was also the exact place where Dougal himself went skiing on January 17, 1977, just a few days after finishing the first draft of his novel. Ariane, at work, was strangely uneasy.
Suddenly I pick up the phone to call him, and then I put it back down. I says, he's not even back home. Why do I want to talk to him? You know, it was obvious he couldn't be there and back in that time. And again, it was just really weird. And then, strange. Eventually, they phoned the guides and the police, and they went to check, and sure enough, there had been an avalanche. They could see the tracks go in and not come out, and I just spent the night in a corner just waiting and just waiting and waiting and waiting and hoping and being very much alone, of course. Sorry.
Big Ali and myself were co-opted to carry the coffin, which was surprisingly light, I remember. Maybe